four types of welfare: the good, the bad, the ugly, and the to be determined. I'm Mark Stewart Greenstein. This is another edition of the Daily Fire. So I want this to be classified well because that word has such searing dimensions for a lot of people. Let me classify in that order. The good. Welfare done privately is very good. It is the individual helping one other individual or a group. That's with their labor or their money. It works so well, and most of us have done some, okay? Giving to the Salvation Army, helping on a kid's field trip, being part of a gardening group that is for the municipality, doing time that helps a homeless person get on his feet, even helping medically where possible, old age homes where they do some low-level services and let civilians help out. That's helping people without a benefit to you. That private welfare is so good because the recipient knows who the giver is. The recipient probably develops a bond, and the giver, him or herself, is far closer to the beneficiary than when using the state as an indirect conduit. Yes, good welfare tethers the receiver to the giver. That's not a bad thing. Forging bonds privately is good, and we don't have to use a not so nimble bureaucracy for it. So here's the bad. The bad is when it does come from that not so nimble bureaucracy called the state government. Municipal government sort of in between. State and federal never work as well as private. They can't, okay? They don't have the ability to discern who is really needy versus who's a scammer. They don't have the ability to say to somebody who was disabled at work and needs to recover and needs income along the way that, yes, you're still needy, we're giving you a check, versus you're a scammer who could be back at work and you just like sitting on the couch. The huge detriment is to those kids often who observe the sitting on the couch over and over and over again with somebody who doesn't want to work, and their kids then think this is the norm. My daddy eats bonbons and he's really good at game shows on television. Why others go out to work 40 or more hours a week is not this kid's concern. And the family gets by on your money. Some families do better than get by. They have lots of beneficiaries and they know how to work the system, and they end up with more income after taxes, significantly more than a lower middle class worker. That's unfair. It's galling. It needs to be ended. Here comes the ugly. You thought that was ugly? We all see that. We know that. Here's the ugly welfare. It's the welfare to state workers who don't deserve the lavish compensation that our General Assembly allows them over and over to have. They are working, yes, but they're getting paid twice as much as deserved. That may be more than a whole EBT plus rent-free apartment plus all sorts of Obama phones. You know, the package that a high-paid state worker who's not doing his job well gets compared to somebody struggling and getting welfare, that's even more gone. Collectively, state employees with their huge benefit packages, they're no better than the rest of us. That's collectively. Now, individually, some of them are, okay? They're specialists. Some of them are very assiduous. Some of them have abilities that most civilians lack. But when they bond together and put the strong, good employee with the weak and protect them, not the weak so much as the scammers, the ones who don't even want to work, then you have an ugly, ugly system. How do I know that they're overpaid? Well, because they're so clinging to their benefit packages. They won't go out on the private marketplace because the private cannot pay them for the work that they're specialists in any other way than the state government's extra benefit package. Even the non-specialists, okay, they're not even close, actually, okay? They're getting an above-average wage that can't be met in private. So how can I say your compensation is too high? I don't know this. It's the free market that's saying this. And that skills that could be done in the free market, I'd like employees to use it. I'd like there to be a fluidity. And good for you if you can get a better job outside of state government. We'll lose you, but somebody else in Connecticut is gaining you. Good for everybody that way. But if you realize the best thing you're getting is on the backs of 3.6 million taxpayers, then you're getting an undue benefit. My kind of reform is to strengthen unions, but they got to strengthen themselves first. Get rid of bad workers. When your union is willing to not protect the routinely bad, the incorrigibles, you've got an ally in me. All right, finally, there's the unsure whether welfare works, and I refer to corporate welfare. Corporate welfare, the giving of state money as sort of an investment. It has never been studied well whether it is a good investment. I do think it's worth still a trial in Connecticut. We seem to have some bad, we seem to have some good, and maybe 5 to 10 good years of study with more screws put to the recipients will benefit us. Here's what I mean by screws. You act as a recipient like you would from venture capital money. VCs in private add not just money, but expertise. And they tether the management to perform or that management is out. That has not been the case with traditional state loans. They don't change the management. It's a windfall to them. And if they don't do so well, so be it. It's not investors that are back at our doorstep. When we can be ferocious in getting the return that we expect for an investment that I'll still call corporate welfare, we'll all be better off.